lovingkindness, God who meets the needs of all living things, and especially attends to the prayers of his people, we invoke thy name, pray thee to incline thine ear towards us, but incline thine heart towards us too. Love us freely. Give thyself to us afresh. Be here for us when we seek thee, and be found of us. And we pray that thou wouldst bless our service of worship this morning and this evening. We consecrate the day, which is thy day, to thy praise and glory. We pray that all that we do may be in the honor of our God, that in no way may we offend, but so control us by thy Spirit and through thy word, that we may please thee and bring pleasure to thee. So hear us in our prayers, pardon all our sins, draw near to us, O God. Thy nearness is our delight, it is our very life. To know thee is eternal life. We ask thee to make thyself available to us to be known, to be loved, to be adored. And we ask it through Jesus Christ, the only Savior, in whom our trust is. We ask it in his name. Amen. We sing together from Psalm 103. The Psalm 103 from verse 13 through to verse 18. And the tune is Howard American, which is number 202 in the Red Psalter. The tune 202, the Psalm 103, verses 13 to 18. Such pity as a father hath unto his children dear, like pity shows the Lord to such as worship him in fear.
Such pity.
Thank you.
The Old Testament reading this Sabbath morning is taken from the book of Numbers, as we continue reading in that book, the book of Numbers, and this morning it is chapter 8. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto Aaron, and say unto him, When thou lightest the lamps, the seven lamps that shall give light over against the candlestick. And Aaron did so. He lighted the lamps thereof over against the candlestick, as the Lord commanded Moses. And this work of the candlestick was of beaten gold, unto the shaft thereof, unto the flowers thereof was beaten work, according unto the pattern which the Lord had showed Moses, so he made the candlestick. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Take the Levites from among the children of Israel and cleanse them. And thus shalt thou do unto them to cleanse them. Sprinkle water of purifying upon them. Let them shave all their flesh, and let them wash their clothes, and so make themselves clean. Then let them take a young bullock with his meat offering, even fine flour mingled with oil, and another young bullock shalt thou take for a sin offering. And thou shalt bring the Levites before the tabernacle of the congregation, and thou shalt gather the whole assembly of the children of Israel together, and thou shalt bring the Levites before the Lord. The children of Israel shall put their hands upon the Levites, and Aaron shall offer the Levites before the Lord for an offering of the children of Israel, that they may execute the service of the Lord. And the Levites shall lay their hands upon the heads of the bullocks, and thou shalt offer the one for a sin offering, and the other for a burnt offering unto the Lord, to make an atonement for the Levites. And thou shalt set the Levites before Aaron and before his sons, and offer them for an offering unto the Lord. Thus shalt thou separate the Levites from among the children of Israel, and the Levites shall be mine. And after that shall the Levites go in to do the service at the tabernacle of the congregation, and thou shalt cleanse them and offer them for an offering. For they are wholly given unto me from among the children of Israel, instead of such as open every womb, even instead of the firstborn of all the children of Israel, have I taken them unto me. For all the firstborn of the children of Israel are mine, both man and beast. On the day that I smote every firstborn in the land of Egypt, I sanctified them for myself. And I have taken the Levites for all the firstborn of the children of Israel. And I have given the Levites as a gift to Aaron and to his sons from among the children of Israel to do the service of the children of Israel in the tabernacle of the congregation and to make an atonement for the children of Israel, that there be no plague among the children of Israel when the children of Israel come nigh unto the sanctuary. And Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel did to the Levites according unto all that the Lord commanded Moses concerning the Levites, so did the children of Israel unto them. And the Levites were purified, and they washed their clothes, and Aaron offered them as an offering before the Lord, and Aaron made an atonement for them to cleanse them. And after that went the Levites in to do the service in the tabernacle of the congregation, before Aaron and before his sons, as the Lord had commanded Moses concerning the Levites, so did they unto them. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, This is it that belongeth unto the Levites. From 25 years old and upward they shall go in to wait upon the service of the tabernacle of the congregation. And from the age of 50 years they shall cease waiting upon the service thereof, and shall serve no more, but shall minister with their brethren in the tabernacle of the congregation to keep the charge and shall do no service. Thus shalt thou do unto the Levites, touching their charge. Now in this chapter, the 8th chapter of Numbers, we have an introduction in the first 4 verses concerning the lampstand which stood in the holy place of the tabernacle. That is, next to the holiest place of all, where the ark was, the other side of the veil, in the holy place, stood this lampstand. And it was the source of light in the tabernacle. What does the lampstand represent? Well, a case can be made out very clearly that it typifies or prefigures Christ himself. He is the light of the world, and he is the one who brings revelation and understanding so that we can appreciate the things of God, just as the light enabled whoever entered into that holy place to see clearly what God had appointed. Jesus himself said, "I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." But in a secondary sense, we know that the lampstand represented the people of God, the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said to his people, his disciples, that they were the light of the world. And the apostle speaks in his letter to the Philippians, chapter 2, of believers shining as lights in a darkened world. So there's a secondary sense in which the lampstand represents the church. And when we come to the book of Revelation in the first chapter, we have the 7 churches of Asia Minor likened to the lampstand, the 7 branched lampstand of the tabernacle, later the temple. So we are right to see a picture here, a sort of prefiguration of the church itself, a church which is established to bear witness, to bring the light of the gospel into this world, and to be faithful. If we think of the lampstand as the church, we can understand Aaron here, who lights the lamps, the 7 lamps that give light, as a prefiguring of Christ himself, our great high priest. And he preserves the light which is in the church. He gives us of the oil of the Spirit. He tends to us and sanctifies us by his grace, so that the light shines brightly. And the Lord Jesus is always minding our needs and supplying those needs and helping us to be good witnesses for him. Now, from verse 5 to the end of the chapter, the emphasis is upon the Levites. Those were a kind of, or they made up a kind of priesthood in Israel of old. They were helpers to the sons of Aaron, who were known as the priests. There was a time when God said that all the firstborn would be his to serve him. And then came the time when, instead of taking claim of the firstborn, he set apart the tribe of Levi. And every male of that tribe was to exercise a priestly service in the tabernacle and in the temple. Now, we're told here that the Levites were taken in verse 6 and they were cleansed. The Levites typify and represent the people of God. The people of God are likened to a kingdom of priests. And by God's grace, the people of God have access, which is what the priests historically had, access to God and to the throne of God. And so, in a way, when we read of the Levites, we are reading of ourselves if we are Christian people and know the grace of God in truth. Because we have been taken, verse 6, taken by the Lord himself, taken out of the world. He has taken, Peter says, a people for himself from among the Gentiles. And so grace has separated us and has brought us to the Lord, and we are his. And then it says they are to be cleansed, and that is true of the people of God. They have been cleansed. Their natural sin, their original sin, as well as their actual sin, is like a stain upon them. But through faith in Jesus Christ and the blood of Christ, we are washed. We are forgiven. The stain has been removed. You remember how John writes in 1 John chapter 1, the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. And so we are separated by God's grace, and we are washed through the blood of Christ. Now, three further things were deemed to be necessary. In verse 7, you read of the sprinkling of the water upon them that will represent the giving of the Holy Spirit to them, and the purifying, renewing effect of the Holy Spirit. And then we read also in the verses to follow that they were, verse 7, to shave all their flesh. I think if we look at that detail and try to find spiritual significance, it will mean that renewed by the Holy Ghost, the sprinkling of water, they will renounce their natural strength and their own ability, as in ancient times it was understood that a man's strength often lay in his hair. He was strong and he was mighty. So the shaving of the head would indicate the renunciation of all claim to power and strength of ourselves, and our power is from the Lord. And then they were to wash their clothes at the end of verse 7, which means, I think, that they were to have a pure walk, a walk of holiness. In the book of Revelation, it speaks of those who were in white raiment, and it means who lived holily. So these Levites knew the work of the Spirit, and they didn't trust in their own strength. They trusted in Christ, and they lived holily in this world. All this is true of God's people. And so the type very much holds. And what is their purpose? Well, their purpose is to do service to the Lord, and that service can't be done without the Holy Spirit and refusal to rely on our own strength and without holiness. So these things are all important. But then in verse 8, we're told that they are to take a young bullock with his meat offering and another young bullock for a sin offering. They are to rely upon sacrifice. And that indicates that God's people, represented by these Levites, rely upon the sacrifice of Christ, represented by these offerings, a sacrifice that deals with sin, a sacrifice that is acceptable to God, fragrant, of a good savor unto God, like the burnt offering. Their trust must be in him. And what is their duty? What is their charge? Well, it's given at the end of verse 11, that they may execute the service of the Lord. That's what they're called to do. That's what they're prepared to do. That's what the grace of God enables them to do. And they have access to God, and the Levites rendered service to God in the sanctuary, and they lived for God. And God's people are just as the picture is here of the Levites. They are given access. They have a service of prayer and of praise and of good works to perform. And all their life is taken up with the doing of the will of God. And in this, they're separated from all others. Unlike all others, the Levites were a distinct tribe, priestly tribe. And God's people, separated from all others, different from the world, they are devoted to the Lord God. And so, as we read this chapter, which seems quite remote to us and somewhat strange, perhaps some would say irrelevant, if we try to look at it spiritually and take the key of God's word for a right understanding of it, we'll see that the Levites tell us what sort of people we ought to be: holy, near to God, living for him. That is our priestly service. And the Lord will enable us to derive benefit from a chapter like this if we understand these things. Now we'll sing from Psalm 132, two short portions concerning the priests of old. The tune is St. Andrew, which is 93. The tune 93, St. Andrew. And we are singing verses 7 to 9 and then 12 to 15. 12 rather to 16. 12 to 16. So that's Psalm 132, 7 to 9 and then 12 to 16. And the tune 93, we'll go into his tabernacles and at his footstool bow. Arise, O Lord, into thy rest, the ark of thy strength and thou. O let thy priests be clothed, Lord, with truth and righteousness, and let all those that are thy saints shout aloud for joyfulness.
We'll go.
For our New Testament reading, we turn to the Gospel of Luke and chapter 11. Luke's Gospel, chapter 11. And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And he said unto them, When ye pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. For we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And he said unto them, Which of you shall have a friend, and shall go unto him at midnight, and say unto him, Friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine in his journey is come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, Trouble me not, the door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him, because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needeth. And I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth, and to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? Let us seek God in prayer. O Lord, our God, we bow our heads before thee, and we humble ourselves in our hearts. For thou art the great God of heaven and earth, and before thee the nations are just as a drop in the bucket. Thou art so great that thy greatness heaven cannot contain, nor the earth. Thou art greater than all others, greater in power and in strength and might, but greater in every perfection, greater in holiness, greater in faithfulness, and greater in love and mercy and grace. We take it upon ourselves, encouraged by thy inviting word to offer to thee our praise and to declare these things of thee, which is part of our reasonable service, to extol thee and to magnify thee in words which are appropriate and words which are glorifying. Oh, help us, we pray, and to speak wisely and rightly, reverently of thee. And we come into thy presence and into thy courts with praise. We praise thee for not only being the God that thou art, but a God to us who believe in thy name. Thou hast blessed us from the beginning of our lives in this world, even before we knew of thee, and before we turned to thee, before we loved thee, thou didst love us with a prior love, and even with an eternal love. The mercy of the Lord from everlasting. And we are so staggered at the thought that from eternity thou didst know us as the object of thy compassion and pity, and thou didst separate us from others to be thy people in due time, and thou didst love us before we had being, before we knew existence, loved with everlasting love, led by grace, that love to know. And we look back upon our early years, years of unbelief, in which we knew the love of God. At least at the time we may not have been fully aware of it, but now with hindsight we can see instances and evidences of thy care from the very beginning. Thou didst keep us before we believed in thee, and thou didst preserve us until the day when, by thy distinguishing grace, thou didst call us to the Son of God, who became our Savior, that we might live and live forever. We bless thee for that day. We understand the sentiment of the one who wrote, "O happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God." It was a happy day. It was the happiest day of our lives when, by love divine, we found the God who is revealed in Christ as a saving God, as a keeping God, a God who brings all who trust in him at last to heaven. And we reflect upon the blessings we've known since believing, and they appear to us to have been more abundant by far. And every day we have known thy loving care of us, and thou hast loaded us with benefits. We have received forgiveness for our failures, guidance in our waywardness, recovery when we have fallen from thee, and supply when we have been needy, and hope when we've been near to despair. And thou hast answered prayer, and thou hast taken to thyself praise on account of thy great kindness to us. Thou hast given us friends, Christian friends, who have strengthened and helped us. Thou hast given us a church in which we can hear the word of God and worship thee according to Holy Scripture. Thou hast given us the fellowship of thy people, available to us in every time of need, and when we are feeling lonely, and when we have almost given up. Thy people have rallied to us, and they have surrounded us with affection, and they've met our needs in a practical way and manner. And oh, we thank thee for the friendship of thy people and the great source of strength that they are to us as we journey on through this world to a better world on high. And so we have a great deal of thanksgiving to pour out before thee. Sometimes we are quite overwhelmed and profoundly moved at the goodness of God towards us. What shall I render, the psalmist said, what shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits towards me? We ask the question, what can we do? And what can we say? And how can we show our gratitude? Like him, we will take the cup of salvation and we will call upon the name of the Lord, and we will pay our vows now in the presence of all his people and pray that we will be kept to the end, being true to our promise to be the Lord's, not for time, but forever. We ask thy blessing upon us today. Thou hast given us encouragement in that passage, recording our Lord's own words. Ask, and it shall be given unto thee. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, God of lasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Jeremiah, let me remind you, was called to be a prophet in the year 626 BC. And his was a notable ministry which spanned over 40 years. It was during Jeremiah's time that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, attacked Judah, and many Jews were taken into captivity to spend no less than 70 years in exile. In this particular part of Jeremiah's prophecy, possibly delivered in the midst of the siege of Jerusalem, he holds out hope to the people, hope of a brighter future, and even the distant hope of the blessing to be enjoyed when the promised Savior comes, the blessings of the gospel itself. He anticipates in verse 1 of this chapter that the time will come when God's people will be reinstated into the privileges of God's people, and God will be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall make up his people. And then a moment's reflection, and in verse 2, he reflects on how once the Israelites escaped from the murdering sword of Pharaoh, and how during the wilderness they found favor with God, who accompanied them and who brought them at last to their rest, that is, into their possession of the promised land. And that reflection enables Jeremiah to build his own hope, and he hopes the people's hope, to believe that the time will come when Israel will again escape, this time the sword of the Babylonians, that once again they will find favor of God, and that God will bring them back to their rest, to the promised land. In the third verse, Israel is introduced as recollecting and remembering God's former mercy to them. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love, therefore with loving kindness have I drawn thee. So the God who delivered from Egypt, what Jeremiah is saying here is this, the God who delivered from Egypt is the God who will deliver from Babylon. The God who showed our fathers favor will surely show their children favor. And the God who brought them to the promised land after 40 years in the wilderness will bring his people back into the land of Canaan again, that they might possess it and rest forever in that land. I was again moved when I recalled this passage this week by the third verse, Israel's words, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. It's not only the children of Israel can say that, derive comfort from that, but I think every child of God who has been brought by grace to God can say this. These are the ultimate blessings of the gospel age, and these are the blessings with which we are familiar in this day of grace in which we live. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. It's one of those verses in the Bible that I think one could say of it, it's a beautiful verse. A beautiful verse. And it gives us three things to consider. First, God, the Lord, hath appeared of old unto me. The second is love, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. And the third is power. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Powerfully, effectively, to be mine forever. God, love, and power. The first heading, God, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me. Cannot the Christian believer say the same thing? Use these very words to describe the grace that he has known in his own experience. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. Friends, God must come to us, and he must make himself known to us. There are two reasons why that must be so. The first is our creaturehood. We are finite creatures. We can't, therefore, by reason of our finite nature, comprehend the ultimate mystery and glory of God. It is ever beyond us, and it seems unreachable to us to grasp the mystery of God. And therefore, God himself must make himself known. The second reason is our sinfulness. Because we are fallen, our faculties, which are limited anyway by reason of creation, but those faculties are impaired by reason of sin and corruption. And therefore, we have tremendous difficulty in thinking aright of God, because sin gives us a warped view of God, and it interferes with any right understanding of God. So in the Word of God, we find men nonplussed by nature. How can we search him out? We find in the book of Job. And we find men distressed by reason of sin, their hearts being darkened, and the cry going up, "Oh, when wilt thou come to me? Oh, that I knew where I might find him." So God takes the initiative. He does what human nature cannot do. He overcomes what a fallen nature will do. And he appears unto us. And this divine visitation, that's how we would describe it, is an act of grace, emphasized by a question perhaps: why should God bother? Why should God make himself known at all to the likes of sinners as we are? The answer is grace. God excels in showing love to the undeserving and those who have not merited such favor. And that is what grace is. It's love to the unlovely, that they might lovely be. You have in Psalm 8 the psalmist looking up to heaven, saying, "What is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that thou visitest him?" We're nothing. We're nobody. And yet God, in his love, stoops down to us and appears to us, introduces himself to us, discloses himself in an act of revelation. This is something intensely personal, caught here in the words, "The Lord hath appeared of old unto me." It is a special manifestation, and it's not given in any general common manner, but it is something specifically related to us. We have a disciple saying at the end of John 14, "How is it, Lord, that thou wilt manifest thyself to us and not to the world?" It's a profound question. How is it? The Apostle Paul speaks in Galatians 1:16, and he says, "God, who separated me from my mother's womb, called me by his grace and revealed his Son in me. I understand that to mean revealed God in the person of his Son in my soul, so that I truly knew who was my God and who was to be the object of my trust. Thus it is that God's people have knowledge and they have understanding. God appears. God comes out of the shadows. God draws aside the veil. God is known. He was known in Israel as he graciously revealed himself to that ancient people. And he is known to Christian believers today. We know him, John says, him that is true. God has given us an understanding, says John at the end of his first epistle, that we might know him that is true, even Jesus Christ, whom God has sent. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. It is an essential experience. It removes all the darkness of unbelief, and it removes the darkness of doubt and of fear. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. And it makes us to say with Paul, I know whom I have believed. So often in the epistles of John, we have those words, we know, we know, we know him that is true. And that is born of experience. It brings sure knowledge. It brings real assurance to us. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. How do we know that he's done that? Well, those who have received this spiritual appearance, and that's what it is. It's nothing physical, that's not seen or felt, but it is a self-disclosure of God to our hearts. And we can know that we've had it because once we've had it, once God is known by us, he thrills us. And he fills our souls with joy in believing and with peace. There is nothing like it, my friends. Nothing like it. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. He appears through the word of God, makes himself so real to us as we peruse his word. And he appears through the Spirit of God, who takes of the divine things and shows them to us, makes the God of Scripture a reality. In this way, God appears to us. the Lord hath appeared of old unto me. Can I describe that any further, I wonder? Well, as the Lord may give help. This appearing, what shall we say of it? It is God drawing near to us. It is God coming nigh to us. So that we become aware of him. It is God manifesting himself to us, showing us how great he is, how good he is, so that we begin to perceive that God is very wonderful. So he draws near. Our souls catch some glimpse of him. A glimpse, I say, but enough to overwhelm us. And suddenly we perceive God as we've not hitherto perceived him. In the words of Psalm 36, in thy light do we see light. God grants us revealing light, and we see through that light the God who is light, in whom there is no darkness at all. The Lord hath appeared of old unto us. That appearance will probably mean that he grants us some token of having made himself known in this way. I thought upon the Song of Solomon in chapter 5. Remember how the Beloved, representing God himself, calls and knocks, and the believer is indifferent. And so the Beloved God withdraws, turns away from the door. And when the believer tries to open to him, respond to him, he has withdrawn himself. She cannot find him. But there is something on the handle of that door. There is ointment, grace, to assure her that he has come. It's a little token, love gift. And God sometimes makes us certain that he has been with us when he leaves us a little favor, some evidence that he's been with us. That may be a free gift, and it may be some blessing inwardly felt, but we know whence it has come. It is from the Lord. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. What has followed? When the Lord appears to us, there is communication. Tomorrow morning, early, if someone knocks at your door or rings your doorbell and you hasten to see who it is. And you open the door and there's no one and there's nothing. You are perplexed by that. You would think if it was someone who wanted to visit you, there would follow some communication, that the person would stand at the door and wait, and then he would greet you, tell you why he has come, perhaps deliver a gift. So with God, when he appears to us as of old, he introduces communication. We come to know God in a more familiar way, and he deals more familiarly with us. And there is some little token, a kindly word, a lovely gift. That's why he has come. And we can then say, the Lord has come. The proof of it is here. This note, this present. So may believers say, the Lord has appeared to me. I have a word from him, which came through the reading of the scripture. It was made very precious to me. I have a special blessing of peace and of hope, which he left me when he came to me. Now I know, with God's people everywhere, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me. He spoke, and my heart leapt at the sound of his voice. He opened his hand, and I was moved at the generosity of his kindness. He blessed me. I know the Lord of old hath appeared unto me, God. And friends, it's not only at the beginning of the Christian life that we need this, but we need it time and again as we live our Christian life. We need God to break the silence. God to come out of hiding so that we can say, the Lord hath of old appeared unto me. We need that reality of God in our lives, the felt knowledge and experience of God. And Christianity is not creedal only. Christianity is experimental. Something must be known and felt. True religion's more than notion. Something must be known and felt. That was Hart in one of his poems. It's that must be known and felt that is before us here. The Lord hath appeared unto me. How grace deteriorates in us and with us unless there is vital experience. How it all becomes so dull and so lifeless unless God meets with us. We long for that every Sabbath. When wilt thou come unto me, is our prayer. And we are happy when we can leave the house of God and say, the Lord appeared unto me. I felt him in the sanctuary. I heard him in the sermon. I received his blessing and the benediction. Truly, he appeared unto me this day. Oh, friends, do look for it. Don't be satisfied with anything short of it. To know God is the marrow of our faith, the essence of our creed. For the appearance of God to our hearts, we long and yearn. There is no substitute for that. God. Secondly, love. Yea, I have loved thee, he says, with an everlasting love. What's the force of that first word? Saying yea. The force of it is truly. I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Oh, friends, what we learn here of God himself. God, says the Apostle John, God is love. And what he means by that is that God, as he has been made known in the gospel, is most conspicuous by reason of his love. That's what comes across to us. That's what affects us when we think of him as revealed in the gospel, as revealed in Jesus Christ. Love, the leading attribute of God, the brightest perfection of God, as made known in the gospel, is love. God so loved the world. God commendeth his love toward us. See, dear friends, that it is God's love for us that is mentioned here, not our love for him. I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us. 1 John 4:10. And how that brings a beautiful view into our experience. What is more beautiful than love? When we see love expressed, we are so affected. We can be moved to tears. Perhaps we see it in a mother's sacrifice for her child, to her loss, to her hurt. Love is a beautiful thing. Perhaps we hear of it. And even though we don't have first-hand knowledge of it, we've heard it by report, but it still affects our hearts. Love. There's nothing more lovely than love. And especially that love which is highest and noblest and best of all, the love of God. I have love thee. So what makes up love? Well, you know, the old theologians used to speak of a threefold distinction in love. They said, there is the love of benevolence. That is where love often begins, wanting the good of another. Benevolence is in God. He wants our good. He wants to bless us. He wants to satisfy our hearts. The second is beneficence. That is actually responding and bringing good to another. God has thoughts toward us, benevolence, but he has deeds toward us, beneficence. He actually blesses us. He gives us of his goodness. He answers our prayers. He satisfies our desires. He realizes our hopes. Truly, says the psalmist, God is good to Israel. And then thirdly, there is the love of complacency. That is the love wherein God doesn't only think good toward us and do good for us, but actually delights. Delights to think these things and do these things, and delights in his people in that love of complacency. The Lord's pleasure is in his people. And he rejoices over them with singing. Zephaniah chapter 3. Oh, how God delights in us. And when this love is shown to us, and God confirms, I have loved thee with everlasting love, then we are transformed inwardly, outwardly. Why are we so sad? God loves us. Why do we doubt? He loves us. Whence come these fears? He loves us. The voice of God to human hearts is this: I have loved thee. Nothing else matters. And nothing else can break our peace. When we can sing, loved with everlasting love, led by grace, that love to know, Spirit breathing from above, thou hast taught me, it is so. Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Everlasting. That means that the love that God has for us had no beginning. If it did, we might wonder if one day it will have an end. But the quality of God's love is eternal. It had no beginning and shall have no end. It is everlasting. And it's the love which distinguishes God's people from others in this world. I have loved thee. With an everlasting love. It's the love wherewith God from eternity has pledged to be our God, never to leave us, never to forsake us. I have loved thee with everlasting love. I have willed in my love never to let thee go, so that none shall ever pluck thee from me. I have loved thee with everlasting love. In your good days, I still love thee. And in thy bad days, I love thee still. It is everlasting love. Even when you depart from me, and when you backslide, and when your back is toward me, I do not cease to love thee. I have loved thee with everlasting love. And for the believer, how great the comfort. If I was loved once, I am loved now, and I will be loved forevermore. The love of God is unchangeable, immutable. This gift, this calling, is without repentance. God does not change his mind. He does not alter his course. Whom he loves forever. And to know and to feel that love is to be blessed. We thought earlier of the appearance of God. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me. Wherefore did he appear to me and make himself known to me? Because prior to that, he loved me. And that is why he appeared to me. And that is why he became my God. And I became his child. It's all of love. God, love. And lastly, power. Therefore, with loving kindness, have I drawn thee. That is, to bring you to myself. First, I drew near. I looked upon thee, and thy time was the time of love, and I loved thee. And then I could not avoid drawing thee into my arms, into my heart. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. It's not the drawing of the body, it's nothing physical, it's the drawing of the heart. It is something spiritual. And we would think it's an experience to covet and to know, but the strange thing is, such is sin and unbelief in us that we withstand it sometimes, and we don't want to come to him, and we don't want to be his. We want to spend more time with the world. We want to enjoy life. We want its pleasures. And that's where the power of his loving kindness comes in. I have drawn thee. The meaning is, I have overcome the reluctance of thy heart to be mine. I have overcome the disinclination for you to be the Lord's. I have drawn thee with the cords of a man and with the bands of love. And thus I have brought thee to myself. My power has overcome thine unbelief. It has overcome the resistance of thine heart. It's overcome all the apathy, the lethargy. Which is so prevalent within thee and in my loving kindness I have drawn thee, and the result is that you are mine and only mine. You have yielded to me. You have sought me. You have found me. And it's wholly by my grace I have drawn thee to my side. Do you not think that that love and that loving kindness which drew you first to believe and to receive the Lord thy God will keep thee? Has he drawn thee to lose thee? No. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee, and with loving kindness I will preserve thee. Thine forever, God of love, hear me from the courts above. Thine forever may we be, in throughout eternity. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Where am I this morning? With God. Embraced in his love, kept by his power, I am the Lord's. And it's all of grace. He appeared. He loved. He drew me. And I followed on, charmed to confess the voice divine. May this beautiful verse be beautiful to all of you. Amen. The Psalm 102. We sing 13 to 16. The tune is Eric Stein, 197. Psalm 102, 13 to 16. The last verse reads, when Zion by the mighty Lord built up again shall be, in glory then and majesty to men appear shall he. 102, 13 to 16. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.